Changhua Christian Hospital in central Taiwan. And they followed, the researchers followed 276 caregivers at the hospital who comes to, you know, get the dementia care for their care recipients. And mean age was 54 years old. Okay? I think that I see some of the family caregivers probably around that age or a little bit older. And 53% were female, 29% were spouse, 43% child, and 19% child-in-law. And the person that they were taking care of was average age of 80 years old.
因为有翻译，我就简单讲一下哈，就是说今年在有一个研究在就是藏话基督教医院276个照顾者哦，然后他们发现说平均年龄54岁啊，在问说在座各位可能也有类似这样子的状况，你可能是女儿、配偶，也可能儿女哦，照顾平均80岁的家长。
And 44% of the caregivers were at risk of depression. And higher depression, they were experiencing higher level of depression when the care recipients were experiencing higher level of care. So ADL means feeding, toileting, all that, right? I don't have to explain, okay? And so when the care recipients required higher levels of ADL and IADL assistance, and also dementia caregivers really experienced higher level of depression, and other mental health problems, neuropsychiatric problems, other mental health problems, anxiety, and some other behavior issues. And also, especially people who had stroke and then that developed into dementia. That was really difficult for them to take care of. Here's the translation.
事实是他这特别指出说，有忧郁症，有可能有忧郁的危险，那特别是需要复杂的生活层面上的照顾，精神的问题，还有甚至譬如说中风，有时候又同时引起了失智，这样是非常非常难照顾的。
So I'm going to tell you about the in the United States, the things are not that different. So in, this is the 2015 data last year, okay? The, when these people were surveyed, about 11% or 10.7% of the US population have provided informal caregiving. That means that they provided caregiving for their family members or friends or without getting paid for their caregivers. And, so the of the caregivers, 60% were female, 40% male, 49 years old on average, and one-tenth of the caregivers were 75 years and older. So elderly themselves were providing caregiving for other people. And I see that all the time. In my current research, actually, a lot of my clients are really disabled and homebound, and they are taking care of their 91-year-old mother or father. And they just really are suffering from depression as well as physical health, you know, themselves. And about the quarter, about one-fourth of them have provided care for 5+ years. So it's a long-term commitment, right? It's not gonna end just in a year or two. And many of them actually continue to provide caregiving for more than 10 years. Because once you get the dementia diagnosis, people usually live 10 to 15 years. That's a long-term caregiving. So you can see here, the of the care recipients, 22% suffer from Alzheimer's or other dementia.
好，有翻译的我就不重复啊。那老师特别指出说，第二个就是说老照顾的问题，在美国有十分之一的照顾者里面是75岁以上，所以他说他常常在他的研究或是辅导当中呢，发现有那种自己都失能的老人在照顾90几岁的爸爸妈妈这样子。 还有就是，四分之一的人超过5年以上的照顾，很多是在照顾失智者。失智者一旦被诊断到最后，可能都是10年到15年的历程这样子。So,
you know, President Kennedy, right? President Kennedy's nephew came to our school, and he was taking care of his father, who had dementia. It's actually Sergeant Shriver. Who, yeah, Sergeant Shriver. And so Mark was calling himself love giver rather than caregiver. Because it's really we are providing love. So that's why we started to call informal caregivers or love givers. So you are providing a lot of love for your loved ones. Yeah, love givers. So, of course, this is very rewarding because you are providing a lot of love, right? Still, it's very stressful. We heard from you and you. It is very stressful, especially if you are carrying out your job responsibilities and other family responsibilities. Of course, you have family members, take care of other family members, your husband, your children, etc. And especially because these days, because of the medical advances, a lot of older adults, even with many physical comorbidities, they live much, much longer. I mean, a lot of people live into 90s, right? So again, as I mentioned before, the caregiving duration is extended. Some people are providing caregiving for 20 years or more than 20 years. And it's never-ending, actually, responsibilities and comes with a lot of stress. And as I mentioned again, dementia life expectancy is 10 to 15 years after the onset. And physical demand occurs when you are having your, let's say, elderly relatives at home. You have to help them to take shower, turn around. I know that I was changing my father's diapers. He was very embarrassed, of course. But I said, Dad, you did that for me when I was young, so don't feel bad about it. But my mother was actually taking care of him when he was, bedbound at all. And especially at nighttime, when he wants to get up to go to the bathroom because he didn't want to wear diapers at night. And he was just pulling it all the time. So those are physical demands because you are sleep deprived. So that's again, important source of your depression and other forms of caregiving burden and stress. And again, some of the dementia patients have very, very difficult behavior patterns. Some people become aggressive. Some people become really angry. And some people become just really, wandering around, right? So you have to constantly monitor their situations. And of course, I mentioned earlier that you have other things to do, your work, your family, and of course you feel also very, guilty about not providing the best care that, in your mind, the best care that you want to provide for your parents. So that's good.
他说那个大家可能听过甘乃迪总统有没有甘乃迪总统的一个外甥呢也是他们曾经辅导过或是说一起来做这个照顾的人然后他说他那时候在照顾这个男士呢在照顾他自己的爸爸的时候他说他不要认为他自己是照顾者他说他是那个爱的提供者所以就有那个 love giver 他说不要叫 caregiver 叫 love giver 这样他说可是虽然呢我们大家提供了非常非常多爱给我们的家人呢可是因为工作要平衡自己的工作要平衡然后还要照顾父母配偶子女啊种种工作业所以生活非常压力非常大加上这个被照顾者呢因为现在医疗进步可能有多重的疾病可是都还活得好好的那很多的人曾经可能觉得是一个照顾者是一个无止境的路二十年可能都还没有结束这样所以有时候呢会非常耗体力有时候失眠这些都是导致忧郁的原因负荷的原因他说像他自己的爸爸当时呢是换尿布就是穿尿布然后爸爸还是很男人主义就拒绝让他换然后就告诉他爸说事实上我小时候也是你换的这样子可是晚上的时候爸爸不喜欢那种感觉就喜欢呢想要自己上厕所那所以呢你们就会大家照顾者就会常常觉得说晚上他起来又更危险所以就不敢合眼啊不敢睡觉这样子所以特别是如果照顾失智的话呢失智会生气有暴力行为游走这些都是非常非常的耗精神的
So, of course, you have to ask for help. But there are good and bad sides of asking your other family members to help you, because you know, the studies have shown that family caregivers who have support from other family members are doing better. Of course, you can go to you know, take a bath in peace once in a while. And you know, other family members can do some grocery shopping and providing instrumental support. That's a good part. But also, you know, when family are all involved, there might be some conflict because you know, your sisters, your brothers may not agree with you at all, and they may come in. And there are actually a lot of you know, in Texas, there are a lot of Hispanic family members, right? Spanish-speaking Hispanic family members, in their culture, it's like an Asian culture, so they really do not like to put their parents in nursing homes. So one caregiver, let's say the oldest sister, is taking care of the parents and can't do it anymore, really. So decides to put mama in a nursing home, and all the siblings come and really say that you can't do that. You cannot put my parents in a nursing home. So I've seen family members do not speak to each other. They become really enemies. And so a lot of conflicts are there too. And also, some family members do not ask for help from the family, other family members. And then they just expect that, let's say, I will expect my brother to you know, provide support without asking him to do that. And my brother doesn't know anything about it. So in the end, I get really mad at my brother, and I've seen that, like, family conflict coming up. So again, one important aspect of caregiving is that you have to ask for help. You cannot just expect that your family members, other family members, will provide you. So I've seen my, actually, clients, their siblings were really in conflict, and then they were blaming each other and all these things. So I'm going to also talk about the California sister syndrome. Have you ever heard of that California sister syndrome? That is that, you know, the main caregiver is doing all the work, and then the you know, sibling comes out of town, comes from out of town, and then sees that, no, sister, you can't do that. You have to do a better job than that, and really messes up. So we call it California sister syndrome. Living far away, sibling would come and really blame the main caregivers for not doing the right job, right? And I, whenever I see that, I always advise that California sister, write down what is most important for you. Do not say anything for now, right? And then after you go back home, and then think about it, your list of things that you saw your sister was not doing well, and then talk about it with your husband, your children, and then decide whether you are going to call the main caregiver sister and talk about it. And most of the times, if they have enough time to digest, they understand, oh, my sister is doing her best. So again, you know, right. So that's what it is.
Right. 所以教授提供很多家人，到底是帮助到底是好的还是不好的，感觉上越多家人来帮助好像是越好，没有错，有时候可以休息一下，这个上个厕所都还可以喘息一下，或是家人可以帮你去买东西啊，种种种种。可是家人的冲突也不少，那他提供了非常多的情况，譬如说在他们德州呢，很多拉丁 族裔的人，那拉丁族裔的人也是一个非常重视家庭观念的人呢，所以呢，兄弟姐妹大家一起照顾就会产生兄弟姐妹的意见不一样，然后不一样呢，就每个人都有意见，那有时候譬如说一个例子是，这个长女呢，好不容易照顾妈妈，可是照顾好久好久，实在压力太大了，终于把妈妈送进了安养院，结果其他兄弟姐妹说，你怎么可以把妈妈送进安养院，就怪这个姐姐做的这种决定这样子。那再来就是因为这样，所以很多兄弟姐妹因为这样意见不合呢，就吵架，甚至不讲话了。这在他的辅导里面也非常多。那他说到一个重点，就是说有另外一个案子是说，他不会求助，不会跟家人说他有困难，所以呢，可是甚至是更是说期待他的兄弟姐妹，这理所当然要来帮忙啊，怎么还要是我说他才要来帮忙啊？所以 照顾者自己不想去，不没有那个动，没有自己去求助，然后期待他的兄弟姐妹要知道他需要什么这样子，所以这也是造成很多的误会跟争吵哈。然后或是说有那一种，他说加州姐妹花哈，这个案子就是说一个姐姐呢就照顾啊，照顾的很辛苦很辛苦，妹妹从外地来了，然后就告诉姐姐说。你这里做不好，那里做不好，这里应该怎么样，那里有，就那个外地来的人就是很会下指导棋这样哈。他说遇到这样的状况，他提供一个方法，就是说如果你是那个外来的人哈，你应该要做什么，就是你去的时候，与其你开始被他叭叭一直讲哈，你就把它记下来，你觉得哪里不好哪里不好哪里不好哪里不好，记下来以后呢，回到你的自己的家的时候，告诉你的先生或是告诉你的自己的这个儿女，然后讲出来以后，他说往往哈发现就是说他能够缓冲一下，不要马上把这些他觉得不好的东西哈马上发泄出来的时候，回去自己看着自己写的东西，慢慢的这个反思，慢慢的消化的时候，会发现说啊，其实姐姐其实已经也尽很多的力，很辛苦这样子。
And this is the process, stress process model of caregiving. This has been developed in 1990s, but it's been still used because it's really comprehensive model to understand the caregiver stress and how that caregiver stress may lead to some very important mental health issues and physical health issues, etc.So first of all, caregiving, you have to really look at the contextual factors. That is our culture.
文化
And socioeconomic status. If you have a lot of money, you can hire full-time caregivers. Although full-time caregivers can be really, not satisfactory, or the caregivers will have some problems. My mom used to fire a lot of caregivers. So she did not like the unclean people, whatever, so, she had her own problems, etc. And, of course, family network and personal histories. Whether you have had a really great relationship with your husband and, wife, or you have had great relationship with your parents, and you feel really great affinity with parents. So that's the contextual factors.
这个压力过程模式呢，虽然是90年代的一个模式，可是到目前为止，应该这个学者发展出来还是一个最完整的。那他去指出有非常非常的阶段或是构面，影响到最后一个家庭照顾者的心理哈，或是生理，或是甚至自我放弃所有的事情，这样于是哈就是有点想切割这样。那最重要的是来自于第一个部分是文化啊，社经地位啊，家人的情感互相的强与弱啊，自己的对于这个自己的这个认识这样啊，包括说他说如果你经济不错，你可能可以请一个全职的照顾者哈，请来帮忙，可是也要看那个人个性怎么样，像说他妈妈就请了全职的帮忙，可是他一天到晚就在fire 他们哈，因为他不满意他妈妈有洁癖，所以就不满意请来帮忙的人这样子。
And next factor to consider is whether the caregivers themselves have internal coping resources, that is strong personality, ego strength, and these things. So they are really better equipped to deal with a lot of difficulties and stress. And of course, social support is an important factor too.
再过来就是那个照顾者本身的适应能力，还有人格特质哦，他是不是一个很固执的人哈，或是一个很吹毛求疵的人哈，这方面其实是蛮重要的。再过来就是社会的支持系统，他自己的家庭支持系统。
And of course, you can see the primary stressors. That is number one stressors are care recipient behavior, right? Especially in the case of dementia.And care recipients, care needs, ADLs and ILDLs, right? And then also carers, that caregivers, subjective stress. The subjective stress can come from the burden of the behaviors and care needs, but also the caregiver themselves may have a lot of other stresses related to their job and their family issues. So these are primary stressors that really affect caregivers.Mental and physical health.
刚刚前上面两个都是背景哦，那再过来就是最重要的压力源哦。第一个压力，第一层面的压力源是来自于这个被照顾者他的一些行为哈，比如说刚刚有举例说失智者的行为呀、啊、哈，还有那个被照顾者他的需求是什么哈，需不需要有很多面向需要照顾？那再过来就是照顾者本身呢，他的主观压力是什么？那主观压力可能来自于他的那个被照顾者，也有可能来自于他自己现在生活要平衡工作啊，种种种种。
Yeah, and then of course, everybody is carrying more than just one role. You're not just a caregiver. That's not your identity, right? You're a teacher, you're a nurse, you're, parents, you're a teacher, etc. And you are really carrying a lot of the stress from your other responsibilities. And also, you have social life. I mean, you have to maintain your friendships, otherwise you will be totally socially isolated.So again, those are really important role strains. And also, many people have financial problems, of course, because the medical care cost is really expensive in the United States. I know yesterday I saw your National Health logo, right? So Taiwan is much better, but in the United States, actually, to take care of your care recipients is very, very expensive.Medicare does not pay all. Medicaid is only for really poor people. So some people are really bankrupt. Actually, half of the bankruptcies in the United States are because of the healthcare cost. Yes.
所以第二层的压力哦，刚刚有第一层，现在第二层的压力是来自于说，每一个人生活上有很多种角色。你绝对不是单一只有照顾者角色哈，你可能还是员工啊，你还有很多很多生活层面上，你还是爸爸，你还是儿子，还是种种种种其他的角色。然后你也要保有一些社交的一些状况，包括你也要培养继续跟你的朋友有一些社交的这个友情上面也是很重要。那有一些人当然经济上面也是一个很重要的问题哦。那他说很多在美国啊，很羡慕说台湾有全民健保，在美国的话，这个健保非常非常的贵哈。然后医疗非常的贵，然后只有这种落入到低收入户的时候，可能政府才会帮忙。他说现在在美国个人宣布破产的哈，一半都是因为付不起医药费这样子。
I'm gonna tell you a story about financial problems. I have a client. I'm currently having the NIH. NIH funded research, and I serve a lot of low-income older adults. And one gentleman who's 70 years old.He lives alone, his children live far away. But we found out that he has to take 15 different medications. 15, that's actually quite average. And he could not afford because Medicaid program only pays for 3 a month. So he was spending all his money and he cannot really spend a lot of money for food because he has diabetes.So I sent out my social worker and then asked him to come up with all the list of the medications. And then next time when he went to see his doctor, discussed the doctor, with the doctor the medications. So we were able to reduce his medication from 15 to 9. Still a lot!
所以他讲一个经济上的故事哦，因为那个他说他有一个这个非常伟大哦，这个要得到这个研究不简单，就是美国国卫院的一个研究是在研究低收入的老人的独居关怀的这一块的方案。然后他说有一个个案是75岁独居啊，子女都住在很远的地方。那因为他就是经济上面一直因为需要去买药，他一天要吃15种药哦。然后呢，在美国这个即便有那个医疗，这个药是不给付的哈。那即便如果低收入户的话，15种药只给付3种这样子哈。所以他就所有的钱都用在买药，买到说他的钱其实都在买药，然后不足买这个食物了，自己都没有食物买，付不起这样。那所以呢，他就把这个15个药就一写起来，建议他的这个社工就是说写起来。下次去看医生的时候，坚持就是要求医生帮他调整、调整、调整。后来从15个降到9个这样子。
So you can see another factor that affects mental health and physical health of caregiver is the caregivers often suffer from low self-esteem because they feel a lot of guilt and they are tired, of course, and they are isolated from their friends. and just they feel really inadequate. They're not doing great jobs in many different areas. So they suffer from self-esteem, and they also suffer from lack of sense of control. That means that, oh my God, this is beyond what I can do, right? And self-identity is also at risk because they say, what am I doing here? You know, I can't do one job, you know, adequately, because I can't do my job really, you know, my work very well because I have these caregiving responsibilities, and I couldn't sleep very well for a week because I was taking care of my dad who was waking up constantly at night, have to change his colostomy bags. Have you done that? His diapers and colostomy bags, have to give the medications, etc. So a lot of caregivers suffer from these intra-psychic issues. So they feel stressed out. And that all these factors affect, as I said, mental health, physical health, and finally some people say, I can't do it anymore, okay? And let's just put my parents to nursing home, but that never ends. Nursing home issues never ends, actually. So in California, I think it's the Dr. Guo's alma mater, UCLA team called it caregiving, what is that, job. It was, it's a job. It's actually a full-time job. It's not just, you know, what you do in a couple of hours a day. So caregiving career, it becomes your career.
他讲到我的老师，所以我要去猜他。他说，除了这些外在呢，其实很严重的一个问题是，照顾者本身内心的冲突哦。那这个是来自于自己生理性跟心理性，就是说他可能会很没有自尊，很累，很孤独，然后很自责，然后再过来就觉得自我越来越没有办法控制哈。有太多这种干脆已经都是忘我了，没有我了，就是说我常常会问自己说，我到底在干什么啊？这样工作也做不好，家人也照顾不好，睡也睡不好，然后工作又一大堆，然后爸爸的那个尿布没了又要买哈。他说这样种种种种那个心理产生的所有这些心理的因素，就是这一格这样子哈，全部合起来就会造成照顾者在心理层面、生理层面，还有最后很多放弃的。哦，会这个比较严重，是说算了算了，把爸妈送到机构最好了啦。哦，可是他说其实送到机构这个工作没有停止哈，还是另外开启另外一章这样子。所以他说我的老师曾经对这种现象叫做这个是一个叫做照顾者的生涯工作哈，就是说永远无止境这样子。
So let's talk about the caregiver depression and anxiety that a lot of surveys of caregivers.Show that about 9 to 30% of caregivers suffer from depressive symptoms or diagnosable depression, depressive disorder. That means really depressive disorder is a diagnosed condition which is serious. Serious depression is found in 9 to 30% of older caregivers, especially people who are really taking the caregiving, you know, sometimes 24 hours a day, they suffer from depression at a higher level. And in Taiwan, earlier study that I mentioned, it shows 44% of the Taiwanese caregivers suffer from depression. And surprisingly, actually, there was no difference between spouse caregivers and adult child caregivers. They were both suffering from depression at a very higher level.And also, when you are a care recipient, your parents, your spouse, your grandparents really suffer from serious illness. And they are in the ICU, intensive care unit, hospitalized. They found that 75% of the caregivers suffer from depression. That is 3 out of 4 caregivers suffer from depression. And a study that followed through caregivers for 24 months, that is about 2 years, right? And these are people who did not suffer from depression at the beginning. But after 24 months, 37% suffered from depressive disorder. That is really serious depression, diagnosed depression. 55% suffered from anxiety disorder. and 32% suffered from both depression and anxiety disorders.
简单讲一下哈，就是老老照顾的老年照顾者，其实忧郁的这个指数是从有可能是从9到30趴，而且在台湾他发现说有研究说你是照顾父母的，或是你是照顾配偶的，哦，有44%的人可能就有忧郁症状哈，可是是照顾父母或是照顾配偶的这个好像没有特别的哪一种是比较有差异，可是合起来是43%有照顾有那个忧郁的状况。如果你的父母亲可能被照顾的人是在 ICU 啊，很重症的时候，几乎是3/4的人都有忧郁状况这样子哈。那如果照顾失智者2年下来，从完全没有哈到这个2年后呢，37%有忧郁症，然后55%有这个焦虑症，还有合起来忧郁焦虑的有33%。
So again, I want to mention briefly, what are the depression risk factors among caregivers? As I said, physical strain and fatigue. That means you are tired, constantly tired. You are sleep deprived, right? And when you cannot sleep very much and you are tired, are you going to feel really happy? Or you feel depressed? So it's, yeah,
exactly.
Right, body and mind connection.So if you do not take care of your body very well, it's going to affect your mental health. So this is the really Asian kind of philosophy, right? Body and mind. Now in the United States, everybody talks about the body and mind connection. Before they thought they were separate, but not anymore, right? And another one is really life change. You know that taking care of cancer patients or stroke patients,you realize that you cannot really do the things that you used to do together, right? You could go visit you know, your children, your relatives, you could go to some reunions for high school reunions, etc. So your life has changed. Life situations have changed. So a lot of people really look back and say, oh my God, I can't really you know, do those things anymore. And that's really a source of depression.Well, I'm really stuck. The feeling of being stuck is really a depression risk factor because of that. And the next one is lack of information, uncertainty, especially regarding the prognosis of your care recipients' medical conditions, dementia, because you never know how the dementia patients will behave next time.There is a saying that if you saw one dementia patient, you saw one. It's totally different. Everybody is different. You cannot really predict. So again, lack of information and uncertainty about the future and prognosis, and you don't know sometimes where you can get the information. You may not ask doctors all the time because doctors in the United States give you only 15 minutes per
five minutes.
We always complain the doctors only give us 15 minutes. So before, you know, before I can even talk about the most important issue, your time is up, you're up, right? So that's why lack of information, that's a big issue for caregivers' depression. And we mentioned financial issues.And then, you know, of course, the stress, you know, issues, really. So,
讲一些没有翻到的哈，就是说，他说心脑其实是合起来的啦哈，在国外现在才注意到心脑的连起来的一些合起来影响，可是，在东方。他觉得我们的文化里面在心脑要一起哈，那才不会造成这个忧郁或是心情不好，其实是比较有这方面的那个意识的这样子。还有再过来就是有关说，其实影响忧郁其实很多是生活上面哈没有办法控制的，生活上的改变，譬如说你的照顾者因为中风，不管是配偶还是父母亲，那你可能就这样不能一起出去啦哈，或是你不能一起做一些你们以前曾经一起做过的事，就会开始常常有那种生活卡住了，就是被绑住了这样子。再过来资讯缺乏，它这一块只是说，就是说，其实譬如说照顾失智者，没有一个失智者是一样的，那所以呢，很多的资讯变对别人有用，可能对你自己没有用。 然后有时候你要去问医生，他说在美国呢，他们常常在 complain 说，一个病人看医生一次门诊只能够得到医生的15分钟，那郑芬老师说在台湾5分钟而已这样子哈，所以他说一些重要问题想要问的时候已经被赶出来了这样子哈，所以呢没有机会问，所以这个资讯就非常非常的缺乏，然后对未来又非常不确定性的那个焦虑就产生了哈。
In addition to these issues that we mentioned, especially when you are taking care of patients with dementia, things are even more complex, even more depressive. So again, behavior changes and problems, right? A lot of people change their personalities when they are suffering from dementia. So that's again unpredictability of the patient's behavior and safety concerns.That means that really sometimes you have to watch the, your caregiver all the time. I had a client that I went to visit every other week, and she was 87 years old, a white woman, a very poor family, and she was one of 10 children, and you know, kind of born and raised in a very rural Texas. So she was living in a tiny wooden house.And when I walk in, I see sometimes all 4 storms were turned on. Fire hazard. So because she just forgot to turn off the stove, right? And that's very, very common. So finally, her daughter was 63 years old. And one morning, 7 o'clock, she called me, said, Naki, go visit my mom in a nursing home. She likes you.She's so mad that I put her in the nursing home. She would not talk to me, but she likes you, so she would talk to you. So I went to visit her in a nursing home afterwards. And another one was that, this is actually not my client, but one of my friend's aunt. She was a wealthy Texas woman. I mean, she had a lot of money. Wealthy, like you know, very properly dressed, always hair is done, etc.Once she got the dementia, she didn't want to put one single thread of clothes. She wanted to walk around naked all the time. So, you know, that was so sad for family members because when she was, you know, healthy, that was unthinkable for her. So, again, a lot of those behavior issues, you know, really are risk factors for caregivers.And of course, sadness from the loss of the person, the relationship. A lot of wives or husbands tell me, well, my wife does not recognize me anymore, right? And that's the loss of the person. You know, oh, I saw you, but who are you? What's your name? You know? And that's really heartbreaking. So that's the relationship, the intimacy. So that's another risk factor. And again,As I mentioned, dementia caregivers, because of the safety concerns, you have to watch that person 24 hours, especially persons, those who walk around at night, right? Night walking, etc. And you need some respite. You need some rest. But there are very few programs that provide respite care. So that's, again, depression risk factors. And maladaptive coping. I'm going to get back to this. It does not mean that you're not doing the right thing. It's really indicating that a lot of people who are taking care of dementia care recipients, they really do not know how to take care of the dementia per se, because we don't know much about dementia, right? I mean, we really still do not know. It's the brain. I mean, even if we you know, study brain so much, we hardly understand what's going on. So again, without the proper knowledge, the caregivers sometimes do not do a great job taking care of and meeting the needs of the dementia care recipients. That's what it is, and we're going to talk about it. And of course, when you are always with your care recipients, you are socially isolated. You miss a lot of those times with your friends.Even your children, because you have to be really tied to the person that you are providing care.
Okay.所以遇到失智的照顾者呢，照顾状况，他说有 很多大部分来自于太多的不可预测性哈。那这预测不可预测性，可能首先来自于失智者的个性改变了啊。那个性改变了呢，随时你就要应付他啊。他说他有一个个案呢，87岁，两周他去看他一次，然后结果呢，每次去看他的时候，那个四个炉火都在用啊。然后他就说，哦，这个实在是这个有火灾的危险性。所以过了一阵子，他的这个87岁的个案呢，的63岁的女人打电话给他说，赶快去看我妈，我妈已经换地方了，被我送到这个安养机构去了啊，我妈已经不告诉我跟我讲话了，因为我妈很生气，所以我会跟你讲话而已，所以说叫这个老师来，他只跟这个老师讲话而已哈，信任关系也都改变了哈。第三个翻译上可能是变成比较是啊有一点点错误，是失落的悲伤了哈。那个亲密感，过去跟这个家人的这个亲密感已经不存在了哈，或是渐渐在消失，所以很多的失落。然后再过来就是因为这样，他说大部分很多人啊想是希望晚上的时候，他那个失智的家人呢常常会乱走啊乱跑，他真正的喘息其实是需要晚上好好睡个觉。可是在这个社会上，我们能够提供的这种啊晚上的喘息，或是一些比较假日的喘息，又非常非常的少。那这倒数第二个那个也是，可能他的重新的他的解释是说，不是无适应能力，而是适应错误啊，比较是适应错误。也就是说，老实说，很多家庭照顾者对于失智者呢，他其实不够了解，不懂得他的需求，没有办法进入那个失智者的世界，失智的行为种种，因为我们可能不知道或是不懂，然后常常就会因为这样照顾上，那他等一下会再讲一下，这个适应能力这一块其实是很重要的，那因为长期这样需要绑在一起，会有社会孤立。
So why is a caregiver depression or anxiety or both are so important?Because you can see actually caregiver depression affects care recipients depression and vice versa. You can see that it fits into each other. And then together that you can see really negative outcomes for both caregivers and care recipients.
所以这样的结果就是照顾者跟被照顾者的忧郁这个循环是互相影响的，就如图所示。最后就是两败俱伤，然后两者都是负向的结果。
So I'm going to talk about the treatments of caregiver depression from now on. We provided a lot of background information. So what are the treatments that are evidence-based?
所以再过来就要开始讲一些治疗哈，或是介入的方法。这一些老师提供的介入方法都是实证的哈。
And of course, you can take medication, antidepressant medications, but those medications have very limited effects, actually.
当然，你可以说吃抗忧郁的药，可是很多抗忧郁的药，其实它的功效不完全是可以包含全部的这样子。
And so we are going to talk about psychosocial treatments here. The first one is psychotherapy called cognitive behavior therapy or cognitive therapy.Usually it's about 8 weekly sessions, okay? And the next one is problem solving therapy called PST, which is about 6 to 8 sessions. And in hospital settings, they actually provide just as short as 4 sessions of PST. And I've done problem solving therapy with funding from the federal government, and 5 sessions are enough, actually.That is because people who do not get it in their 5 sessions, the 6th session is of no use.
他说接下来他提供一些比较用社会心理背景的理论 来研发的这个一些可能介入的方法、哦、第一个是认知行为疗法、哦、那大部分是有结构性的一个8个疗程，这样8次啦、哦那再过来第二个是问题解决，然后他说在美国的医院呢也有这个4次哈，那这样一般是6到8次呢，美国也有医院是4次，然后他说他自己也有一个研究呢，他说提供他自己的研究是发现其实差不多5次就可以了，他说如果5次都还没有办法改变或是解决的时候，大部分这个方法是对个案无效的。
And the ones that are also very popular in the United States is called.Mindfulness-based stress reduction, which was which began actually at the Massachusetts General Hospital, the Harvard University Medical Center, in the 1970s. And it has been really gaining the momentum these days. Everybody's doing yoga and, you know, the mindfulness kind of meditations. I'm going to get back and talk about this a little bit more later. And the next one is actually, this is what I've developed, depression self-care management support, because, you know, the cognitive behavior therapy and problem-solving therapy all needs licensed psychologists or licensed social workers. And a lot of licensed social workers who should have at least master's degree or PhD, they sometimes don't want to work with caregivers. They want to sit and then work with really young people or middle-class people, middle-aged people. So we have shortage of mental health workers in the United States. So what we really found was that, well, even if you do not have master's degree, you do not have licensed, you know, licensed kind of the training, you can train the lay people. Like if you have bachelor's degree at least, you can provide 40 to 50 hours of training and they are doing the job great. So currently I'm testing this, and actually I hired two people, bachelor's level people, and I trained them for about 40 hours, and they are doing better job than master's degree people. Sorry about that.
Why?
I think they are really committed, and then it's what they have to do. I will explain why that is the case later on, what this is about, because it's simpler.
Okay.
It's rather than problem-solving therapy, which is 7 steps, this is 5 sessions and 5 steps. I will explain it later.
他说，当然现在台湾也是有流行的这个正向心理的课程，在美国也是一样，然后麻省理工学院，麻省这个哈佛大学，他们其实开始的1970年就开始了，那所以现在很多美国人就是去上这种课啊，然后就很乖乖的去做瑜伽啊什么什么类类的哈，静坐啊这些，然后再过来身体，他说这个忧郁的自我管理，自我照顾管理支持，这是他研发的哈。那他说有时候第一项跟第二项呢，认知行为的问题解决，大部分都是需要这个心理师或是社工师，特别在美国是规定要有证照的哈。那大部分没有这么多的有证照的人，或是说他即便有硕士博士学位，这些人呢，他说常常都不想要跟照顾的人工作啊，哈，可能就去找其他的这个志向。那所以他觉得说，如果没有那么多人有心理社会背景这些专业的训练，然后又那么需求那么大的时候，他后来研发了一个训练一般人大概只要大学生大学毕业就好。然后他说他自己现在也有训练一批40小时到50小时的训练大学生，他发现说做出来成效呢很对不起的，比那些硕士跟博士做的还要好这样子。
And I'm going to talk a little more about the next slide. And you think about this psychotherapy, the counseling. You always think about people sitting next, face to face, right? These days, it's not the case, actually. The face to face counseling sessions are not as prevalent as it used to be, but also people use it through video conferencing methods. So it's just like sitting face to face, but using video conferencing methods or telephone sessions, also web-based sessions. And the United States federal government, the NIH, found actually in-person sessions and tele sessions. Tele means that even through the video conferencing or telephone sessions, there was no difference in terms of effectiveness. Yes. So they do not fund any more comparative studies to compare tele versus in-person.
传统上你想象心理辅导一定是跟一个心理的咨商师一对一见面，面对面这样子来协谈嘛。那随着科技的进步呢，现在有透过网络的啊、电话的啊、视讯的啊。然后他说，过去美国国务院补助非常非常多的研究，在比较这几种哪一种是效果最好的，结果现在都发现完全都没有不同，所以呢，现在美国国务院已经不补助那种一对一面对面的这种任何的介入方案了。 反而是鼓励大家开始研究，有一些是透过网路视讯还是电话上面的协谈，发现效果是一样好的。
Cognitive behavior therapy. Some of you are familiar with CBT because CBT is really the evidence-based for many mental health problems, including depression, anxiety, and even PTSD. PTSD. Right. Okay. So what CBT does is working with therapists, either in person, that is face to face, or through tele delivery. Okay, the therapist really helps you to focus on your thinking process, your thought patterns. So a lot of depressed people tend to be really negative, and they think that, oh, she's not talking to me. It's probably because she doesn't like me. Very simple example. Well, that's exactly not true. She might be having her own problems. That's her problem. It's nothing to do with me.Something like that. So I think the cognitive behavior therapy really helps you to have more positive understanding of the situation. And by practicing the way you see things in a positive manner, it affects your brain. So, even though it's only 8 sessions, you have to do a lot of homework and you have to continue to use the cognitive behavior therapy treatment methods, then your brain gets effective. So these days they've seen brain actually getting activated. They did the MRI after CBT sessions and they found actually the brain cells were activated. So they have scientific evidence that these psychosocial interventions really work to change people's mental health.
认知行为治疗可能有一些伙伴们会知道这个是在做什么的哈。那它其实在这个实证上呢，对于说刚住忧郁、焦虑、创伤症候群，其实都发现是非常有效果的、哦。那其实认知行为治疗讲白一点，就是在认识这个人的这个思考的过程啊、哦，慢慢用这个在思考的过程呢，以比较去了解他为什么会这样子想。那了解清楚那个状况之后呢，要用比较练习，用正向的方法去改变他的思考过程。那不要想说就是这样子协谈的时候就好。他说其实是要很多的练习，很多的再度的再去调整啊、哦。那一直用正向的去思考这个过程呢，慢慢会影响你的大脑在想事情、处理事情跟行为上面。那举一个例子来讲说，譬如说有一个人不跟我讲话。我可能就以为说啊，他讨厌我，不跟我讲话。其实可能是那个人他目前的状况，他有很多自己的状况，所以他根本没有办法负荷跟别人互动这样子。那所以呢，这方面他说，经过这个几次的八次的认知行为治疗以后，去做核磁共振的这个摄影呢，就发现说，脑部的活化是有活化起来的。
And in CBT, it's really working on your thought process, but also all these psychosocial interventions, the psychotherapy includes behavior activation. That means that depressed people tend not to engage in pleasant activities. Used to watch funny movies, used to watch, comedy channels, but when you are depressed,you are really absorbed to yourself. So you don't do that. And sometimes, you would go out and do exercise. Depressed people really tend to isolate themselves at home, right? So again, part of any psychotherapy that I'm talking about, it includes the planning for and engagement in the pleasant activities. That's really big part.
所以任何一种的心理治疗其实都要伴随着一个活动，都要某一种的活动，那大部分是为这个正向，比较偏正向的活动，譬如说刚刚认知行为治疗，我们在说我们一直在了解这个人的思考过程，思考状况是什么，然后可能就要鼓励他做一个活动，就是改变行为， 那那个行为可以是从他以前喜欢做，比如说他以前很喜欢做有趣的事啊，那可是现在为什么不喜欢？好，所以这个伴随着这个活动本身就是要比较正向的，或是说再回去说服他做以前他会喜欢哦，喜欢运动、喜欢做的这些活动这样子。
Let me ask you a question. Do you guys have the CBT Association here that trains people?
我们台湾有这个认知行为协会吗？训练怎么做认知行为吗？
It takes about 40 hours of didactic training, and then after that, you have to work with at least 3 real people to get licensed.
在美国是需要40小时的这个受训，然后最后呢，你必须要针对三个个案做完整的这个操作过后，才能够有证书这样子。
Right, so it's only 40 hours, and so it's not a really, you know.
We only learn it in school.
It's
pretty much, yeah.
Right.
好像在学校学哈。
Somebody should start. Somebody should start CBT association and get training because it's only 40 hours, and then after that you work with three training cases or practice cases. So it's not a lot of you know work, but you have to have the licensed CBT therapist who can train other people.
And who can be trained.
Can be trained master's level, at
no,
least
no,
master's
level.
Trainer. Trainer. Oh, trainer should be the LCSWs or licensed psychologist.
So it's,
yeah, CBT. Yeah,
so
CBT.
Fall in either trainer
oh, yes. Yes, of course. Yes. Right.
陈文老师在为下一次
Chinese speaking. Chinese speaking.
那下次请他来帮我们训练四十小时的这个证书，这样哈，可能邀请。他说在美国的话，就是这个可能有硕士成绩的人哈，就可以去受训四十小时，还有这个协会专门在认证，这样去练习
三个
个案的时候，督导会带着你去看你所有的记录这样子，然后才能够证书。
请问这个硕士是必须是心理学硕士吗？还是一
般硕士 level or any or psychologist
or social workers?
心理或是社工背景的这样子。
Well, you know, in the United States, actually, if you do not have master's degree, you cannot call yourself psychotherapist.
Yeah.
Right.
在美国，如果你没有硕士学位，不能叫做是心理治疗师啦。
Next one is problem solving therapy. This was developed in England in the 1970s originally, and then they migrated to the United States. And a lot of US hospitals used problem solving therapy, which is part of actually CBT, cognitive behavioral therapy, but it really focuses on very specific problems that people are facing. Again, when you are depressed, when you have to solve a problem, what do you feel?
当你如果很
useless,
忧虑忧郁的时候哈，很精神不好的时候，你有什么感觉？
Isolated.
Okay.
非常孤立。
Sad. Okay.
非常难过。
But when you have to solve a problem, we have a problem. How do you approach that? Your emotions take over, right? Your reasoning abilities really get reduced.And because your emotions take over, so rather than solving problems, you get even more frustrated. That's why problem-solving therapy really teaches you the coping skills of how to solve a problem using your brain rather than your frustration and sadness. So it's a seven-step approach, which is really, really kind of specific. So initially,You have the problem, and you really dissect problems into small bite pieces, okay? And then really look at, okay, what are the potential solutions in here? So do the brainstorming, pros and cons. And what are the barriers? What are the really wonderful outcomes that may come from each solution, okay? And then you practice it.And you evaluate it. So you go through the seven steps over and over again. So you train your brain again how to really zero in on the problems. And instead of using your emotions, using your brain to go through each and every step. Once you do that, you can really have a better coping skills, better problem solving skills.
Okay.
那个问题解决这是在英国1970年代的时候开始的，后来在美国也大量被使用，在美国最常被使用是在医院的工作体系里面。那它必须就是首先你必须要解决，譬如说你要是有一些问题的话哈。就是比如说很聚焦的一个问题，那可是当你情绪不好很忧郁的时候，平常我们如果遇到困难有问题的时候，当你情绪都不好了，你一定是用更多的情绪去阻挡它。好，那可是这个就是也类似像刚刚的认知行为，是教导你的脑怎么去适应或是解决现在可能面临一个小小的问题。那它必须有7个步骤哦。第一个步骤就是先界定这个问题，一定要把他那个医师人员可能就帮跟他一起去界定这个问题，要界定的很清楚。然后呢，把这个问题切成小小的、更细致，就是说去解析这个问题就是了哈。去把它解析这个问题以后呢，切成小小块的时候，意思就是说再过来去想说这些小小块的小问题可以一一怎么样来解决，然后甚至呢要跟这个个案。互相来看说这些问题你要解决的话你会遇到什么样的阻力、这个阻力要如何克服，一步一步一步这样慢慢，然后如果可以解决的话就会有什么样的好的结果、那最后再看说我们解决这样子来解决的时候是不是可以完成、就是帮你处理了现在面临的最大的困难。他说这个一步一步其实是用你的大脑在适应你现在的状况，而不是用情绪来处理你现在的状况这样子。那久了以后就是教你的大脑怎么开始去思考，怎么去改变，去面对你的困难这样子。
Okay, I'm going to give you an example that I just got an email from one of my PhD therapists. I hired five therapists in my project.And one of them just emailed me right before I came here. About, yes. So this is a gentleman who is Hispanic, a Spanish-speaking person. And he's 73 years old. He was taking care of his wife. But his wife passed away about 5 months ago, heart problems. And he was so sad. And he kept on telling us that he had the best time of his life before his wife died.So he doesn't want to live anymore. He's really depressed. But we found out that after he started working with our therapist, we found out that he's not sleeping very well because he's not taking care of himself. But most of all, he's not eating very well. Well, if you don't eat very well, you're going to be depressed, right? So that was the problem that our therapist identified.How can you eat better? And what are the problems, the barriers to eating well? He doesn't have a transportation to go to grocery store. Okay? So my therapist and the client worked together to have the, what they call it, the special transit service for elderly people. And he applied for the program, was approved, and so that... The special van would come and pick him up and then go to the grocery store so he can buy enough food. That was one of the PSD sessions.
所以他举例哈，你会发现说这些问题都是小小问题，可是是重要的关键这样哈。那刚刚遗漏的就是说那每一个步骤啊，就是治疗师跟这个个案就是一起脑力激荡这样子，然后这个很重要的一个陪伴的这种动作哈。所以他举一个例子，就是刚刚他说今天要来之前，他的那个助理们哈 ，email 他的一个问题，是因为73岁的长者男性啊，他5个月之前丧偶了啊。那因为丧偶，他觉得说他人生最好的时光已经没了啊，最好的时光全部都在跟太太一起的美好时光，所以他根本不想活了啊。所以这我们可能也会有时候会看到这种案子。所以呢，他的这个治疗师就发现说，他现在也都没有在睡觉，然后甚至没有吃，因为非常非常的忧郁，所以像没有吃，这就是一个问题，那所以他们就决定说要处理这个没有吃的这个问题，吃不好，没有在吃，第一个发现说怎么吃，他连要去买食物都有困难。所以更不想说吃，所以呢，他们就必须要跟他一起脑力激荡，说怎么样 才能够你愿意去吃一些东西，然后帮助你是不是比较容易取得食物这样子。那想到最后有一些方法就是说，哎好，后来这个治疗师就帮他连接到美国有交通接送服务，是可以带这个长者去买菜的，买完菜回来，那这个长者还愿意自己来拿起来吃，所以这个就解决了这个现在没有吃的问题，所以类似是这样子的一个方法。
Actually, I can just do Chinese. Skip the English version. We are running out of time. Actually, why does CBT and PST, these kind of psychotherapeutic interventions work? It's because it focuses on here and now problems, right? Rather than talking about what happened when you were, 20 years old, 15 years old.Actually found out that those, talking about those past problems don't help you at all in terms of your depression. You have to focus on current, here and now problems, and then CBT and PST really focuses on that. Second one is that compared to the medication, once you take the antidepressant medication, the second time on, the psychiatrist will always tell you, you have to take it forever.
Yes.
Right?And a lot of people don't want to do that. So compared to antidepressant medications, this psychotherapeutic interventions teaches you coping skills that you can practice and practice, and you get better and better, and your brain changes. So that's why. The next one is it's safe. Because psychotherapeutic interventions, I always tell my clients, older adults are always like, why do you think that I should do that? I don't think it's going to work, becausedepressed people have lack of motivation. That's part of depression, right? And I always say, what do you have to lose? Nothing. Nothing to lose. So it may not work for you, right? The CBT or PST may not be the right treatment for you. But in the end, you could have spent really nice time with some nice person, your therapist. So you don't have anything to lose. And it doesn't have any side effects.Because we are not prescribing any medication. So,
yeah, okay. 好，所以为什么这两种有效呢？其实它是聚焦在现今很现实的、马上的、现在遇到的问题，而不是在回想说20年前怎么样、怎么样、怎么样哈。所以是马上希望就是用很短期可以解决的，面对现在的问题这样，而且。常常如果因为你是忧郁，在吃抗药有抗忧郁的药，医生可能就会说，就是一直永久的吃下去了哈。那所以有一些人不喜欢这样子，一直要吃药，所以抗无药物的副作用。再过来就是说，他说长者常常会说，啊，这个有什么用啊？哦，没有用啦，没有用啦哈。因为那个忧郁的人就是不想动，不想想嘛，他就说啊，这个没有用这样子。他说他常常会鼓励长者，就说或许没有用。可是呢，他也没有伤害啊，哦，那试试看啊，或许就有一线希望这样子。
Okay. And I'm gonna just leave it here because you can actually look at the website in here. Mostly it's the meditation and yoga, and look at the nice yoga pose, down dog.
Right.
Yes. And I'm actually. Telling a lot of people to do the yoga because it will help you a lot in terms of body and mind. So I'm going to just leave it here because of our limited time. You can read it, okay? And then next one is the, of course, physical exercise, which is wonderful, which is free. You don't have to pay the therapist at all. So why... The exercise is good for depression or mental health in general. Well, we found out that actually the brain dopamine, which is responsible for your happiness, happy emotions, positive emotions, gets activated when you are exercising. So yoga, same thing. So do yoga, do exercise, any exercise, Tai Chi here, right? And cycling, bicycle, etc.And also, when you are doing yoga in group settings, the group interactions also help the social aspect. So again, exercise in group settings, which is free, which is very effective, good for your body, good for your mind. So do exercise. And this is the one that I talked about, the lay providers, only bachelor's level people. And you can see that I wrote the manual based on the other behavior activation. That means, which is really based on, again, exercise, but also behavior itself. That we talk about depressive behaviors and healthy behaviors. And we really encourage the caregivers and other older adults to engage in healthy behaviors, which can be really positive thinking, as well as physical exercise and other very, you know, kind of rewarding activities that people will feel proud about engaging. So that's what I did. And I think the reason why it works is because, as you can see, the person there, the attendee asked why it's working. Because as you can see here, it is very, very simple. You just really focus on your daily activities and try to figure out which is depressive, which is healthy. So again, you try to reduce depressive behaviors and you increase healthy behaviors.
所以刚刚老师就走过了正向减压的哈，那他那个有网站，他说大家可以看，还有运动方面啊，会促进不只是让脑的这个可以更快乐一点啊，然后而且社交哈，如果是团体的话啊，那又会交到很多朋友。 那再过来就是这个自我照护管理的五步骤，他说这个就是像大学生就可以被训练这样，这也是他的研发。他说为什么他会成功，是因为其实他很简单。那这个其实所有的这些东西都是在让你训练你自己的脑，训练你自己的脑。然后第一步骤其实就是开始五个步骤里面就是每天你检视一下你自己的一些行为，哪一些是让你忧郁的。 哪一些是能够让你更健康、更正向的行为，然后把它很有意识的、自觉的先把它检视一下。So
the the counselor comes and works with you, and to identify any barriers to engaging in healthy behaviors, and that's really the part. So again, they don't need advanced degrees to help you with that, right? That's why you know, it's simple enough. It focuses on your behaviors per se, and that's why this is effective. I can't say for now, but you know, last time I included very small number of older adults to test the manual. There were only 6 people, and I was very nervous because this is the first time. And these were very critical older adults. You know, American elderly. They speak their minds. You know, they tell you that this is not working, whatever. So I was very nervous. So I visited each of the 6 people who participated. And then they said, Namki, you finally did the right thing. So.
他说，当时他研发这个东西的时候，他试过一些长者啊。第一次他尝试的时候是只对6个长者，而且是6个非常有主见、自我意识很强的美国长者啊。 然后他就只会他说刚开始的时候他们就讲，说真的吗这样子，直到做了一阵子以后呢，他再去拜访他们，然后每一个长者就说，你终于做对了这样子。Yeah,
especially when people are so depressed, they have so many things on their mind. You can't really focus on too complex a problem to start with, and so again, simple problems. Simple solutions, simple steps, and that's why I think it's working better than actually the other complex psychotherapeutic interventions.
他说，因为忧郁的长者哦，他就是已经都比较不想思考啊，然后比较懒，就是说不想思考、不想动这样，所以这个时候要的是一种很简单的方法，然后很简化的问题，然后让他们很简单的去自我检视一下。 然后来做一些脑的这个练习，然后慢慢让它修正。Yeah,
and in my project, which is funded by the NIH, I got $2.2 million to test this project, and that's going to be 4.5 years.
Yeah. Every year, 2.2.
Wow! I wish. Yeah. And the local foundation gave give me probably, you know, $500,000. I got, so it's together $2.4 million. And so after 4.5 years, actually 4 years, I will come back, probably tell you how it works or not. But I do test it through video conferencing. And this is the what we call HIPAA compliant, because it's a counseling session still. So you have to really protect the individual's privacy. So federal government really you know, ensures that we use the very secure video conferencing platform. So that's what we use. And so this is the provider, let's say. I'm the therapist. And then you go into a session now, and then it will lead to the next session, and the participants actually you know, punch in 9-digit code that is specific to that person, so that it would be really secure between the therapist and the participants. So all we use is actually the laptops, but you can use actually the iPad too. Laptops, and then a lot of our clients do not even have internet connection. They are really poor. So I provide the wireless card, right?
Yeah.
Wireless card. And then sometimes, you know, they need the headphones, headsets. So that's all we need, actually. So, and you can see that this is actually more practical than telephone sessions. You know why? Because in the United States, a lot of low-income older adults get Medicaid phones, government-subsidized phones, which has only 250 minutes.
Oh, really?
Yes.
这个就是老师的研究，他得了这个国卫院4年$2,400,000的这个研究，在做这个这个很大型的研究，不管钱多少，可以拿到国卫院的研究都是非常非常厉害的啦。那他说好，一开始的时候就是设定这种比较，他这个是一个是视讯的这种做法。那美国因为很保护个资哦，所以他在这个要确定，就是说你这个那个辅导员呢跟个案本身两个要互相沟通的时候，可能就要先保确定这个网络是安全的哈，所以就是有密码种种，然后用的器具其实很简单，可能是 iPad 或是这个说的这个手提电脑啊。然后一个耳机，然后因为他说美国很多低收入户他其实没有无线上网嘛哈，所以呢必须要提供这个预付卡让他去上网啊。他说为什么有人说可能会问说那为什么不用电话呢？他说美国的低收入户规定就是说美国低收入户政府会帮你出电话电话钱哈，电话费用，可是一个月只限可以讲到250分钟而已，这样子啦哈，所以就是可能比较不合算，反而是这个会比较便宜一点。
And the reason why I like the video conferencing sessions is because that we don't have enough people to go around to home visit, and also it's more expensive because the traffic in Austin is terrible. So I have to pay them, you know, while they are stuck in the traffic, right? With this one, we don't have to worry about it. So rather than having 5 therapists, 5 counselors, I can have only 2 people serving the same number of caregivers and all the adults.
他说用这个好处也是因为省人力啦哈，因为就不用有这个交通的这个周遭劳顿哈，可能可以服务更多人哈。如果是利用视讯的话，他说他算过哈，5个如果是需要到个人个案的家里这样子跑，5个这个辅导员呢，其实如果是透过视讯，只要2个就够了，这样子会一下可以减半哈人力。
Yeah, all these therapeutic interventions are wonderful. However, when you are taking care of really sick family members, I think that you know, much more effective intervention programs are multi-component psychosocial you know, programs. And that focuses not only on depression, but also stress management per se, and communication skills training. How do you communicate your needs to your other family members to ask for help? And how do you communicate your yourself to be better understood by your care recipients? And again, dementia caregiving, what are the specific steps that you can really utilize to to reduce your stress and to better serve your care recipients. And you also really have to have caregiver support groups so that you can exchange information as well as provide support for each other. And of course, that program includes counseling for depression and anxiety as part of the program.
他说在这个是另外一种方式哦。他说其实刚刚这个用协谈啊什么，当然这些很好，可是他发现很多中照顾的问题其实是多方需求，所以需要就是多面向哦，就是多管齐下这样的意思哦。那所以呢就有一个他表上的哈，除了压力管理之外呢，第二个特别是怎么去寻求帮助这一块，因为照顾者其实要叫他自己求助，甚至是跟家人求助，或是甚至让被照顾者了解他现在是什么样的状况，这都需要很多的沟通练习这样子啦哈。然后再过来就有支持团体种种，还有协谈哦。加一句不是他讲的话，其实家长都在做这些事情啊。
Yeah, I'm gonna, before I talk about the multi-component program, I'm gonna just give you a little very simple approach to ABC, which is really A means antecedent, B means behavior, C means consequences. So it begins with good description of the caregiver problems. Actually, it's caregiver problems sometimes, not care recipients problems.So you kind of see your, let's say your mother asks question, where is your husband? Why is he not coming home in time? Actually, I'm going to use my father's example. My sister-in-law was a high school principal, so she can't come home at 5 o'clock. But my father was a very exact person. So when he was losing his mind,he kept on being very, very exact. So 5 o'clock, the clock, he's constantly asking, where is my daughter-in-law? Why is she not coming home? So my brother wanted to reason, oh, she has too much work. She can't come home at 5 o'clock. Of course it doesn't work, right? And yeah, and my brother was exasperated and say, why that? Why are you asking the same question over and over again?And so I asked him to do ABC. So let's say, when does my father ask the same question? How often? And who is the problem? Is that my father's problem or is my brother's problem? And actually he started to record the how many times my father asked. It was not that many times at all. I mean, he thought it was about 50 times. Actually, it was 5 times. So again, start with good description.And then identify, actually it should be identify, not identity. Yeah, identify antecedent and triggers. When and how, and really, when and how my father asked the questions. And possibly why is he asking the questions? We found out it's 5 o'clock, he was hungry.
Oh.
Right? And because my sister-in-law,is the care provider, she cooks good meals for him. So that's why he's asking for my sister-in-law. She was a home ec teacher, so she always cooks good meals. So again, he could not, my father could not express, I'm hungry, give me something. So we found out that it's always around the dinner time, before dinner time, he asks, where is my sister-in-law, right? So that's again,So you have to find out what are the triggers. So here it is. Chinese translation.
Okay, and 这里有一个错误哈，不好意思，是第二个是行为，上面在后果哈，不好意思，这可能跑掉了哈。对，应该是第一行本来是应该要跑过来哈。所以是前因行为后果哈，这是另外一种方法 ，ABC 方法，他说也是很简单。就是说你要好好的去描述这个状态是什么。他举一个例子，譬如说他爸爸当时开始有失智，然后5点的时候就会一直问他儿子啊，
问他哥哥说你
媳妇什么时候回来，
媳妇什么时候回来，媳妇什么
时候回来，常常会一直问，问到他哥哥都快要发狂这样子。所以呢就好好描述这个状态，然后他譬如说就教导他哥哥啊，去记录一下到底爸爸每一次
次
都问几次，好，什么状况的时候问，然后是什么原因造成他会问，他爸爸个性本身就是一个很怎么讲，很坚持，就是说比较有纪律的人，所以五点的时候就会问，五点的时候就会问，后来就是发现这样，这些行为慢慢记录起来，然后后来也渐渐他哥哥真的记录起来之后，发现说好像也不是那么多次，他哥哥觉得是问了50次，结果其实好像问了5次而已，所以这问题到底是谁的问题？是哥哥的问题还是爸爸的问题？让这个哥哥慢慢了解说，哎，其实好像这两都是两个人的问题哦，都有这样，这个好像是这个问题是其实是互相影响的。那再去了解说为什么会产生这个问题，慢慢用好的前因的这个描述，然后去仔细观察爸爸的行为，后来发现这个后果是，原来他爸爸肚子饿了，那他这个媳妇呢是一个家政老师，然后煮饭煮得很好吃，所以五点的时候他就会非常期待赶快回来煮饭这样子。
Yeah, and then the third one is C, is consequence, ABC. Remember, ABC, consequences. This is the consequences for both caregivers and care recipients. So when my brother gets exasperated, of course my father gets really mad, right? Because he's hungry, and then his needs are not being met, and his son gets really frustrated, etc. And the reason why sometimes caregivers get really frustrated and telling, Mom or Dad, stop asking the same question over and over again, is because they believe that person, my father, has control over it. He doesn't. His brain doesn't work that way with Alzheimer's or dementia. So again, that's and a very simple process of being doing ABCs. And then when you really realize, oh, this is the time when he gets hungry. That's why he's looking for my sister-in-law. So I told him, my brother, well, my father loves, pecans.
What's it called?
Pecans. Yeah. So give him almond, pecans, and he chews on it before his sister-in-law comes home. So problem solved, very simple. His needs were met. My brother doesn't have to be frustrated and start yelling at my father, etc. So that's, again, ABC process. Very simple, very useful when you are using in daily practice.
Okay.
如果每天可以这样子去练习，遇到一些问题的时候就去仔细的描述这个状态，然后去看看他是什么样的行为啊，然后后来有什么结果，说不然的话像他的哥哥呢会因为这样的关系越来越生气啊，越来越生气就造就这个被照顾者也越来越生气，两败俱伤这样子哈。所以后来发现说原来是五点的时候肚子就会饿哦，然后之后呢因为爸爸喜欢吃坚果类的东西，所以就哥哥先给他一些坚果，哎，其实问题就解决了。那这个是小小的事情，可是如果这样子的一个方式呢，可以适用在很多很多遇到小事情的时候，一个一个这样解决。那这个就是练习，然后累积成多，然后我们的脑筋就可以去适应这样子。
So if you look at it, actually, people, care recipients, right? They have unmet need, and then that really causes distress and discomfort, hunger. It could be pain, right? And they can't just express it. That's why they cannot also communicate properly. And that's why they express it in terms of behaviors, disturbed behaviors. So if you understand this, actually, and you try to identify what's the unmet needs, and what's the distress or discomfort that your care recipient is experiencing, that's going to be really helpful. So, we don't have much time, so I think it's at 5 o'clock.
I think 10 more minutes.
10 more minutes, okay.
Yeah.
Okay, great, thank you. Yeah. So, I want to talk about this multi-component programs, focusing on self-care and self-efficacy, because I cannot emphasize enough how important you take care of yourselves if you are caregivers. And you have to have that self-confidence. That is self-efficacy. I can do it. You know, that you lose like confidence and competence that you are going to suffer from depression and anxiety. So take care of yourself and you know, believe that you can do this. It's a very, very difficult task, but you can do that. But how can you do that? You have to learn the skills, right? So again, these are the programs that I have only two in here. The first one is called Powerful Tools for Caregivers, and you can take a look at the website, and that's 90 minutes, 6 weekly sessions. And then the next one is Stress Busting Program for Family Caregivers. That's again 90 minute, 9 weekly classes, and everybody who attended the programs say that that saved their lives. They really saved their lives. So again, that's the programs that you can take a look at. So you have to go to a class to attend this program. 6 weekly classes and 9 weekly classes. And in 2000, when I was in Portland, Oregon, that the Powerful Tools for Caregiver people asked me to test it out with Korean American caregivers. And that's when I translated this book, this earlier edition, this book in Korean, and we tested it out with Korean American caregivers. They said that saved their lives. So again, wish you could have this one. And this is something that without special training, you can actually train you know, bachelor's level people to be able to do that. And you can certainly send some people to Oregon too to get training.
And that would training be... either the trainer?
Yeah, or... yeah, exactly, exactly. So you can
先讲一下哈，再回来刚刚那个金字塔那里，他是在说，所以很大部分的行为来自于说，他其实底下还有很多的这个被照顾者有未满足的需求没被发现，所以你如果能够用刚刚他说的很多方法，不管是认知行为啊，这个问题焦点解决啊，或是说 ABC 这些方法，可能你就会慢慢去知道说他到底是不舒服的原因，也有可能是疼痛啊，可是就是讲不出来或是不能表达，所以这个沟通上面产生最后这个很不好的行为跑出来哦。然后再过来就是有关照顾者啊，一直在强调是说照顾者一定要提升自己哦，照顾者的自我效能，也就是认为自己还有存在的这个能量，哦，这个很重要。所以在美国有这个种子训练，哦，就是说它事实上是训练种子然后下去带课程，哦，然后当然一般人也可以去参加这个课程，网站它都有跟我们提供，哦，是每周六堂，或是每周九堂，每一次不好意思，这是每周六堂吗？不是，不好意思，每周六次啦，哈，每一周一次，这样总共六周，哈，翻译错误的，对不起，我觉得这有点怪怪的，所以九次的是九周这样子的意思，每一次90分钟这样子，哈。那他说2000年的时候，在这个 Oregon 哈，奥奥这样子的市呢，他州呢，他们就是有用这一本书来训练哈，然后来教照顾者，然后每一个人都说，是真的是救了他们的生命这样子。后来他也翻译成韩文哦，然后也在韩国的社区里面尝试，他们也说非常非常有用哦。
And these are the 6 weekly Powerful Tools for Caregiving program sort of curriculum. So you can see the first week, it's taking care of yourself. So the book is chapter 1, taking care of yourself. Chapter 2, I put the marks in here. Chapter 2, reducing personal stress. Okay? And chapter 5 is about, you know, dealing